Hi, welcome to this video in which we will tell you all about printing of solar panels. Yes, you can print solar cells. They can be made at home simply by painting layers of specific material on top of each other. They can also be printed using an inkjet printer. We will cover this and more, including the cost for ink, so stay tuned. At this point, I would like to ask you to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, so that you get notified of all our videos when we upload them. Please also like the video if you find it informative. There are two different types of cells, namely organic and inorganic PV cells, that can be printed. In the inorganic category, it is the perovskite cells that have recently generated a lot of excitement. This is because the printed organic cells normally have a lower efficiency. However, with printed perovskite cells, we are recording efficiency values that are close to mainstream solar cells. Before we begin to unpack the information on the inks or the paints that will be needed, let's understand how solar cells function so that we know how to properly print them and learn what makes them work more efficiently. A solar cell is not complicated at all. In its most basic form, it's simply a layer of photoactive material sandwiched between two layers of electrodes called the charge carriers, or sometimes referred to as contacts. Conductive metals are mostly used as contacts. Photoactive material is just called active material sometimes in the industry. So, can we simply paint photoactive layer between two copper plates and we will have a solar cell? Well, theoretically yes, but practically no. This is because we have to allow as much light as we can to reach the photoactive material. After all, it is the light that knocks out the electrons that will be captured subsequently by the contacts. If the electrode on the top itself blocks the light reaching the photoactive layer, then we won't have any current. So at least one of the contacts that faces the sun ideally should be transparent. If not, then it should be in the form of mesh with plenty of gaps in between, so to let the light through. Now, this is where we have a conundrum. As mentioned earlier, ideally we would like all of the incident light to get to the photoactive material. On the other hand, we also want the contact to be large enough to capture all the excited electrons. A large opaque contact would block the light. Hence, we need to either have a transparent contact layer, which can be expensive, or a mesh, which won't be able to capture all the excited electrons, meaning we would have a very inefficient solar cell. Is there a solution to this? Yes, there is. This is where we can appreciate the addition of an extra layer on top of the photoactive material, which can act as a net for excited electrons. It is normally termed as the electron transport layer. The material is also called the N-type semiconductor, and we can have this material added in the form of a very thin transparent layer. There are two reasons for placing this electron transport layer on top of the photoactive material. First is to catch the excited electrons all across the surface area of the photoactive material. The second is not allowing them to go back, or in electronic terms, not allowing recombination of excited electrons with the base photoactive material. Whenever we paint the ETL, or an N-type material, then a barrier is automatically created at the interface called the depletion layer that blocks any captured electrons to return. This N-type material is kept so thin that it is almost transparent, which allows most of the sunlight to reach the photoactive material. Therefore, we need at least four layers to design an efficient solar cell. Two layers for the contacts, one for the photoactive material, and one for the electron transport layer. The bottom contact can be a simple conductive metal plate. The photoactive layer needs to be thick enough to absorb all the incident light, or made out of material that has a high absorption coefficient. For the ETL, we need a thin layer of transparent material, and finally, for the top contact, we need either a conductive transparent ink or a conductive metal mesh. Normally, an aluminium mesh is used. Now, there are some designs for photovoltaics that may involve more layers. For instance, there might be an additional hole transport layer on the rear side of the photoactive material, but for brevity, we will not discuss those designs. For printed solar cells, any non-conductive material can be used as a substrate, including plastics or papers. Now let's look at all the inks that are available in the market that can be used for each of the mentioned layers. For the photoactive layer, there are a variety of ink and paint materials. These include CIGS inks, perovskite inks of various grades, and also organic inks that have fullerene present in them. All of these can be used for the photoactive layer. For the electron transport layer or the n-type material, again there are a variety of options. These include PCBM inks or zinc oxide ink. A very thin layer of this material has to be printed or painted so that the layer remains transparent. For the transparent conductive layer at the top, one can use transparent graphene layer or indium titanium oxide. A mesh conductive wire is also used, and so is silver paste. You can find all the mentioned inks easily available on the internet. The inks that are printable by inkjet printers need fluidizing agents to lower the viscosity and therefore are more expensive. Here are the prices for some of them. 5 ml of zinc oxide nanoparticle ink can be purchased for $68. 25 ml of zinc oxide ink for inkjet printing can be purchased for $233. Similarly, 1 kilo of indium titanium oxide ink that cures at 230 degrees centigrade can be purchased for $800. 10 ml of conductive silver paste can be purchased for $12. Similarly, 25 ml of production ink for organic active material can be purchased for $518. 100 ml of one popular grade of PCBM ink can be purchased for $282. Note that some of the inks need to be dried before the next layer is printed, and there is a curing time associated with these inks. There are lots of people who have created their own inks for photoactive material using ingredients which you can find in the kitchen. For example, people have made ink using berry juice. Others have used super glue, etc. You can find these homemade recipes for various photovoltaic inks on YouTube and on other web pages. On a similar note, graphene can be extracted from pencil lead using the well-known Scotch tape method. The graphene flakes can then be used with a binding agent to form a transparent contact at the top, although the process is quite tedious. The cells made by printing in almost all cases have a lower efficiency than the cells in the market. However, enthusiasm in printing solar panels hasn't waned. This is despite the fact that two large solar cell printing companies, including NanoSolar, have gone into administration. The reason of excitement for printable solar panels is this fascinating idea of being able to print solar panels on any substrate, flexible or otherwise. Furthermore, it is a low cost and a very productive method that is exactly like printing newspapers using a printing press. Both inkjet printers and reel-to-reel printers can be used. Imagine that by using these inks, someday we will be able to simply paint our walls and convert them into solar panels. It is this potential that keeps both the researchers engaged and the investors interested. And with this, the video is concluded. If you learned something from the video, do give it a thumbs up. Thank you for your attention.